Welcome to the Raw Footage Oscar Preview 2022. This is a series of videos where I will be recounting what I think of this year's Oscar nominations, what I think will win, what I think should win, and any alternative nominations that I think should have happened, any mistakes that I think the Academy has made. This particular video will be for the Best Actress category, and as ever, the selections that I make, alternative to the actual nominations, come from the GoldDerby.com lists of Oscar potential. As far as I'm concerned, GoldDerby.com is the standard for this kind of thing in predicting award ceremonies. And if a performance showed up on the lists on GoldDerby.com, it did have a chance of ending up with an Oscar nomination. And I want these nominations to be somewhat plausible, even though many of the alternative nominations I will make are for very, very tiny films, which had very little chance of getting a real-life Oscar nomination. But I do think all of these performances are worth highlighting, and that is particularly true in this category of Best Actress. Of all the previews that I did for all these major categories, I think Best Actress was the one I had the hardest time finalising my personal list. I think at various times during the process of preparing for these videos, I had about 8 different actresses listed in my personal nominees before settling on my final 5. But hopefully you will be paying attention to the honourable mentions, which I'll be adding at the end of this video, because there were some really, really high quality actresses working in 2021, and many of them deserved nominations. It's just a shame that there are only 5 slots available. And speaking of those 5 slots, let's have a look at the actual nominations for the 2022 Oscars in the Best Actress category.
Nominee:
Penélope Cruz for Parallel Mothers is in a situation somewhat similar to her husband Javier Bardem in the Best Actor category. Inasmuch as I think Penélope Cruz is a remarkably talented actress, she is one of world cinema's great performers, but this particular film I don't think stands out particularly much, and I don't think she deserved this particular nomination. Yes, I think there is some emotional heft to Parallel Mothers, but personally speaking, I think Pedro Almodovar's tendency towards melodrama tipped over the line in Parallel Mothers, and I just don't think it's one of his best. I think it's too broad. What emotional impact is there, I think, is a little bit overplayed, and I just don't think the performance of Penélope Cruz was worthy of an Oscar nomination. There are certain scenes which are brilliantly done, impeccably done, but as a whole, I think the performance of Penélope Cruz in Parallel Mothers wasn't up to snuff, and I don't think she deserved this particular Oscar nomination.
Nominee:
Nicole Kidman for Being the Ricardos is, again, somewhat similar to Javier Bardem in the Best Actor category, in that, in the same film as Javier Bardem, she is performing in a biopic of a very recognisable person. And that's actually kind of the issue, because every time I am watching quote-unquote Lucille Ball on screen in Being the Ricardos, I'm seeing Nicole Kidman. I'm not seeing Lucille Ball. I think it is a very, very hard task to give an actress to perform as one of the most gifted physical comedians of history. And Nicole Kidman isn't necessarily known for her comedy work, and I think she struggles. She doesn't inhabit Lucille Ball. I think the film Being the Ricardos has other flaws, which are mostly the fault of Aaron Sorkin, not Nicole Kidman. But again, for this particular role, I don't think Nicole Kidman was worthy of this Oscar nomination.
Nominee.
Kristen Stewart for Spencer, I think, has finally proved to the world what I've long been talking about when it comes to Kristen Stewart, in the fact that she is a very, very talented actress. She's so far removed from the Twilight saga and has appeared in some really excellent arthouse style films and been very excellent in them. Films like Clouds of Sils Maria, Personal Shopper, Still Alice. Kristen Stewart has for years been a very, very talented actress. And performing as Princess Diana, again, similar to Nicole Kidman earlier, a recognisable historical figure who we are intimately familiar with. And Kristen Stewart, I think, does a good job of performing as Princess Diana. I think the film as a whole has issues. I am a huge, huge fan of Pablo Larraín. He is literally one of my favourite directors in the world. But Spencer didn't quite work for me. It's a little bit too abstract, a little bit too dreamlike for its own good. So as a film, I don't think Spencer works. But Kristen Stewart's performance as Princess Diana, really leaning into her psychological issues, her bulimia, her marriage issues, her desperate need to be a good mother, but being restricted by the expectations put upon her by the family she has married into. All of that works really, really well. The fact that the Academy Awards are handed out in America possibly helps her. I think Kristen Stewart does a good English accent and has the mannerisms of Princess Diana down pretty well, but speaking as a British person, it wasn't quite perfect. But nevertheless, I think it's an excellent performance from Kristen Stewart, and I do think she deserved this Oscar nomination.
Snubbed.
Jodie Comer for The Last Duel is an overlooked performance in an overlooked film. I really do think The Last Duel is the most underrated film of last year. And one of the major reasons for it is the subtle yet strident performance of Jodie Comer. A woman living in a world which is definitively set up for men, a victim of sexual assault, who, given the patriarchal society in which she lives in, her own life is under threat thanks to the actions of her husband Matt Damon in setting up this trial by combat. His masculinity, his pride has been so wounded that he is willing to risk his wife and his marriage for the sake of his honour. And Jodie Comer just has to take it. She has to inhabit this 14th century woman and put enough of our modern sensibilities into this modern day feature film that we understand where she is coming from. And it works really, really well. The hard task of being asked to act out a rape scene not once, but twice, and in each case putting enough subtlety and enough nuance into the performance that I buy what the film is trying to say. I think Jodie Comer does an exceptional job in The Last Duel, and I really, really think she deserved an Oscar nomination for Best Actress.
Snubbed.
Isabelle Fuhrman for The Novice is one of those tiny, tiny independent films that does well on the festival circuit, gets a little bit of attention, but was never actually going to get a real-life Oscar nomination. Isabelle Fuhrman won Best Actress at the Tribeca Film Festival for this film and also got nominated for an Independent Spirit Award as Best Actress. But personally speaking, I think she should have got an Oscar nomination for Best Actress, which is pretty good going for an actress who is probably still best known for playing the little girl in Orphan about 10 years ago, one of the creepier horror films I've ever seen, with a twist I did not see coming. But Isabelle Fuhrman is excellent in this film, which is a little bit like Whiplash meets Black Swan. As A young woman, Isabelle Fuhrman, joins her college rowing team and becomes so obsessed with perfection, becomes so obsessed with being in the varsity boat, that her mental health, her physical health, her friendships all suffer because of it. Putting yourself through extremes of pressure and intensity in order to achieve something like whiplash, having your mental health severely deteriorate over the course of the film, like being Black Swan, I think this is a remarkable performance, which doesn't necessarily go in the directions you expect. In this type of obsessive character, there's usually some kind of goal, there's usually some kind of reason behind it. But in this performance from Isabelle Fuhrman, it seems like she's doing this simply because there's a task in front of her and she needs to be the best at it. Despite the fact she doesn't, you know, quote unquote, need it and other people around her do, she still needs to be the best. And I think that's an absolutely fascinating performance to play from Isabelle Fuhrman. An astonishingly assured directing performance from first-time writer-director Lauren Hadaway, who, before becoming a filmmaker, including working as a sound editor on Whiplash, Lauren Hadaway was a collegiate rower, so uses her own experiences to tell this story, and tells it in a remarkable way. I think Isabelle Fuhrman is exceptionally good in The Novice as this damaged, obsessive character, and in every way, Isabelle Fuhrman pulls it off remarkably well. And despite being in a tiny independent film that nobody's heard of, I do think that Isabelle Fuhrman was worthy of an Oscar nomination for Best Actress in 2022.
Will win.
What I think will win is Olivia Colman in The Lost Daughter. Olivia Colman has established herself very well as one of the top actresses in Hollywood, and yet still finds the time to do some more light-hearted, more comedic fare here in Britain. But Olivia Colman really is becoming one of world cinema's great actresses. I personally think she should have won Best Supporting Actress last year for The Father, and I think she is worthy of winning this category as Best Actress this year for The Lost Daughter. As a self-described unnatural mother who on a holiday in Greece involves herself in the lives of a group of boorish people, including young mother Dakota Johnson, and this allows her to flash back to her own background and history when she is played as a younger woman by Jessie Buckley, who also deservedly got an Oscar nomination for this film. But the questions this film raises about womanhood, about motherhood, about self-determination, about the way you are perceived as a woman if you are or are not a mother. The first question that anybody asks Olivia Colman, you know, this middle-aged woman on holiday on her own, is, do you have children? Where's your children? And this constant background noise of expectancy when it comes to a woman of this age being a mother, and not particularly wanting it, not particularly liking it, but that's what a woman does. She has children, and that's what Olivia Colman to some degree rebelled against when she was being played by Jessie Buckley. Now, looking back on her life and looking on at the seemingly unhappy young mother Dakota Johnson, who is also very good in the film, all these questions about life, about motherhood, about womanhood come to the fore, and the performance of Olivia Colman is excellent. I mean, very, very quiet, very, very subtle, but I think it is a brilliant performance, and I think it will win the Oscar for Best Actress.
Should win.
What I think should win is Jessica Chastain for The Eyes of Tammy Faye. And if you've watched any of my other videos in these preview series, you might accuse me of having double standards. Because in other of these videos, I have complained about the ostentatious, over-the-top type of performances, which sometimes get awarded. And thankfully this year that didn't happen, including Lady Gaga not getting the Oscar nomination for Best Actress she was expected to get for House of Gucci. I thought it was good enough, certainly good enough for an honourable mention in this video. But in general, I don't like the over-the-top performances. And yet, that's pretty much exactly what this performance from Jessica Chastain is. Playing the televangelist Tammy Faye Baker, who by the end of her life and by the end of this film, is a somewhat clownish figure who has makeup permanently tattooed on her face, who has fingernails so long she can't open a can of Diet Coke unaided, is extreme camp, is an icon in the gay community. She's a loud, over-the-top figure. But what this film does so well, in my opinion, and what Jessica Chastain does so well, in my opinion, is show the journey for this character to get there. As a very earnest, very devout young woman with an overly controlling mother, Cherry Jones, who falls under the influence of a manipulative preacher played by Andrew Garfield, who I also think was worthy of an Oscar for this particular film. But with the influences of her controlling mother and her manipulative husband, she gradually finds herself drawn into this extravagant world. She still genuinely believes in the power of God. She still genuinely believes in saving souls. Yet she's living in a mansion and is dripping in furs and has these clownish, elaborate hairstyles and costumes and all that kind of stuff. And the way that Jessica Chastain portrays each aspect of Tammy Faye Baker, I think, is exceptionally good. The very devout, very earnest young woman transformed into this high camp clown by the end. And you believe it, you see it. And the performance of Jessica Chastain, I think, is excellent. And similarly to Will Smith in the Best Actor category this year, I think Jessica Chastain is due. She has never won an Oscar, and I think this finally might be the time where she deserves it, judging what she's up against. So, speaking personally, despite the fact it is a rather extravagant performance, which in general I don't particularly like, I do think that what should win the Oscar for Best Actress in 2022 is Jessica Chastain for the Eyes of Tammy Faye.
Best Actress.
So the actual nominees in the Best Actress category in 2022 are Jessica Chastain for The Eyes of Tammy Faye, Olivia Colman for The Lost Daughter, Penélope Cruz for Parallel Mothers, Nicole Kidman for Being the Ricardos, and Kristen Stewart for Spencer. Personally, what I would take out is Penélope Cruz, and I would also take out Nicole Kidman. And what I would replace those performances with is Jodie Comer for The Last Duel and Isabelle Fuhrman for The Novice. As I said, this was a very, very hard category to judge, but what I think will win is Olivia Colman for The Last Daughter. A subtle, psychologically rich, psychologically intense performance, which really did sing off the screen. But speaking personally, my choice of what I think should win is the much more extravagant, much more elaborate performance of Jessica Chastain in The Eyes of Tammy Faye. I think the journey that she goes on, the sympathy which we as an audience feel for her, the understated writing and directing of Michael Showalter, who I think is much better known as a comedian, but reins his tendencies in a little bit to give a mostly straight performance in this film, I think works well. So all around, Jessica Chastain in The Eyes of Tammy Faye would be my personal choice for Best Actress. But as I've said several times, it was very, very hard to whittle my personal choice down to a final five. And all of these honourable mentions that I'm currently playing in this video will be well worth checking out. And on a different day, if I was in a different mood, many of these would have been in my personal choices as Oscar nominees. But nevertheless, they are certainly worth checking out. And I hope you do. So, if you are so inclined, remember to like, comment, subscribe. If audio podcasts are your thing, you can check out my audio podcast at raw-footage.co.uk. And all that remains for me to say is see you next time, where I shine a light on cinema, both obvious and obscure.